Real Chat Episode 10, North by Northwest.
I'm an advertising man, not a red herring. I've got a job, a secretary, a mother, two ex-wives, and several bartenders dependent upon me. And I don't intend to disappoint them all by getting myself slightly killed.
Cary Grant becomes a secret agent against his will. Propelled at gunpoint onto the highest level of international intrigue. And framed for murder. Cary Grant, running for his life, searching for a man who doesn't exist. And a secret nobody knows. And finding a blonde who has all the answers.
Hello there.
Tell me, why are you so good to me?
Shall I climb up and tell you why?
At breakneck speed, they race together toward the excitement that lies dead ahead, north by northwest.
How do I know you aren't a murderer?
You don't.
Cary Grant, Eva Marie Saint, and James Mason as the man of sinister surprises.
Apparently, the only performance that'll satisfy you is when I play dead.
In your very next role, you'll be quite convincing, I assure you.
The perfect setup for suspense. With the perfect woman and the perfect crime. As Alfred Hitchcock takes you north by northwest.
The master of suspense weaves his greatest tale. Everybody, welcome to episode 10 of Real Chat, a podcast that's devoted to the real world as we know it. Today we're looking at legendary director Alfred Hitchcock's 1959 thriller, North by Northwest, a film considered to be a masterpiece for its themes of deception, mistaken identity, and moral relativism in the Cold War era. North by Northwest has often been referred to as the first James Bond film due to its similarities with splashily colourful settings, secret agents, and an elegant, daring, wisecracking leading man opposite a sinister yet strangely charming villain. My name's Adam Stolfo, and I am joined here today by my good friend, Brose Avard. Brose, how are you?
I am all right. I've seen a bunch of Hitchcock, and I love Hitchcock. Everyone loves Hitchcock. It's just easy, because you've got to love him. But I'd never seen North by Northwest, so I know. I'm getting weird reactions from people around me for not having ever seen this film. What I love about doing this podcast is that there are certain films that I haven't seen, and it's embarrassing that I haven't. And it is also great to be challenged by a film like this and have to sit down and just consume it quickly so we can talk about it. But what a great bloody film this is.
Absolutely it is. And to my left over here, my good friend Andrew McCaskill.
Thank you. Yes, very excited about this film. It's a film I've loved for many years. Grew up with this film. Still incredibly brilliant. And if not his masterpiece.
Also here to my right, Stuart Wilson.
I'm very excited to talk about Hitchcock because at least three of us in the room are crazy Hitchcock nuts. Perhaps four of us. I don't know, to be honest.
Bit of mystery to start the podcast.
If
I can just stir the pot a bit, this is considered to be one of Hitchcock's best. It would not be in my top 10 Hitchcock films at all.
Okay. Controversial.
Yeah.
Controversial. It was definitely underappreciated when it was released.
That goes with a lot of Hitchcock, though.
It does go with a lot of Hitchcock. That is Hitchcock.
That's true.
But whether or not it's still underrated or not, I would say it's interesting because I've lived my 30-odd years of life and not ever seen this film, but I know a lot about this film because it's written about and it's referenced. It's also one of those great films you sit down and watch and goes, oh, that's where The Simpsons got that from.
Yeah, correct.
So it's definitely a film you're going to be instantly familiar with if you've never seen it, but you're going to know it. There's certain elements of this film that are going to be very familiar.
Amazing to watch you watch that for the first time.
If you're a film that you love that I've never seen, you can come over and watch me. Or I'll just live stream it online and people can watch me watching.
That'd be awesome. Live video cast.
There's a concept.
There we go.
Is there a new show coming out that's all about people watching TV? Watching them watch TV?
Yeah, that's right.
This is the first episode of our Alfred Hitchcock Presents retrospective series. Conscious effort to look at the vast body of work of a man regarded as one of the most influential and significant directors of all time. I know that all three gentlemen here with me today are huge Hitchcock fans, and all movie fans out there can rest assured that this is only the first of many Hitchcock retrospectives that we have planned for you here at Real Chat. His filmography is so vast and detailed that it may take some time, but I don't think there'll be any complaints, particularly not from anyone at this table.
We'll get there. If it kills us, we'll get there.
How many films are there all up for Hitchcock? There's like 60 or
60 something. 60 yeah, wow. If you include silent films, I think.
He obviously is someone who sees film as something else, like something to explore and experiment with. It's not like I'm a filmmaker, I make films. He is more of an artist. He's someone who does like press the buttons and likes to kind of manipulate the audience. And you know, he's known for basically conjuring up the film in his head before he even shoots one frame. So it's almost boring, the process of making a film to him.
Ernest Lehman, who wrote the script and wrote it in consultation with Hitchcock, says in the commentary that everything Hitchcock does... It's one of these comments that he makes where you're like... He's saying this because he's the screenwriter and that's what Hitchcock's led him to believe because that's how Hitchcock got him on side. Or is it fact? You know, it's kind of, you've got to take it both ways. But he does say that everything is in the script. That's Hitchcock's done all his work by the time the script is finished, and then it's just a matter of executing the script. I would say there's a little bit of leeway either way with that comment, but he's obviously very detailed when he's writing the script.
And I've heard that many times, and that when he's actually filming, he's actually kind of bored and thinking about his next film.
Yeah. Well, Lehman talks about that as well. When he's writing the script for this, Hitchcock's off somewhere else shooting his previous film and seems more interested in the next one than the one he's shooting at the moment. So
what are some of your initial thoughts, guys, on the film? Like, why is it memorable? Why is it worth revisiting 56 years later?
I'm going to jump straight out of the gate. I think one of the things that helps this film, and especially helps this film in terms of its longevity, is two words, isn't it? Cary Grant. It's his incredible thriller, but with this great sense of humour. And I think that helps. So even now, some of the effects don't look that great, and some of the acting's a little bit old-fashioned, and some of the language is very overwritten or overwrought. Maybe not overwritten, but, you know, it's very stylized, is what I mean. But because there's this kind of this... Cary Grant's just got this little wink and a nod all the way through it, and you really enjoy his ride, I think that really helps, at least in the first act. Really brings you in straight away.
Yeah, I think he's particularly good here because he manages to do that thing where he's consistently cool and suave, yet you also... concerned for him, and he's in fear for his life, and you believe that. And I think that's actually a difficult balance to strike, because if he was just too cool and calm and collected, you'd never worry, and you wouldn't be able to relate to him either. But at the same time, he manages to walk that fine line.
Yeah, I think it's just because it's a culmination of so many things he's been obsessed with over his career. This film, like, it just seems to have been like the big, you know, standout film of his. That, you know, the wrong man theme, the innocent man. There's so many elements like the icy Hitchcock blonde in there, and they're all done to perfection. Like, this is where he's actually just mastered it, and it's there in the biggest scale possible in this film.
See, I thought he was getting a bit sick of this kind of film. He loved the technical challenges, but this whole innocent man accused shtick he'd done time and time again. And as we know, after this, he then went and did Psycho, which, of course, was a complete change. It shook the foundation of Hollywood, I think it's safe to say, and arguably, you know, started the slasher genre, depending on what you think, what your point of view is on Peeping Tom.
Yeah, no, I think yeah, there's some good points. I think, yeah, definitely he needed to stop doing that kind of film. But I think, yeah, as a film, it really does... You can't really follow that up anymore. He's nailed it with this film.
It's so big and flashy, the crop duster scene, the Mount Rushmore scene. He's really just throwing everything at the wall, isn't he? Isn't it just like a big let's...
He is. If we can talk about the crop duster scene, of course, possibly it'd have to be one of
the
Hitchcock's
most iconic Hitchcock. Most,
yeah, that, I mean, the shower scene. Yeah. It's interesting because it kind of, watching it now, kind of sticks out a bit because...
It's so bizarre.
It's such a good sequence, but it doesn't really make much sense.
Because the whole film is set in cities pretty much except for the finale, and then he goes out in the middle of nowhere for no particular reason.
They get him to go out in the middle of nowhere, presumably to kill him. It's not really the middle of nowhere, because in that... How long is the sequence? 8 minutes or something?
Yeah, it's good.
There's like 15, 20 people that pass by. Also, there's...
And the bus seems to come by every 3.5 minutes.
Right on time, might I add.
Yeah, and more importantly, they're planning to kill him with a crop duster. Yeah,
the which least is... effective weapon in the history of murder, I think. What do you do? Well, we'll get a gun? No! You're thinking too small! We'll get a crop duster!
It's so purposefully paced. It's such amazing shots, just on its own. You can see why it's studied in film schools over and
absolutely.
Over.
Absolutely. But Lehman does say in the commentary that he regrets writing in the machine gun that's in the crop duster.
I was thinking that felt like an afterthought, because it didn't really make much sense. Yeah. Also, because how else were you going to kill him without the machine gun?
Yeah, well, he's like, the plan was obvious. He goes, Lehman talks about it like he didn't write it too, which is kind of cute. Yeah. He's 83 or 86 when he does the commentary for the Blu-ray, but he just goes, he's talking about, oh, I guess the idea the thugs had were that they were going to kill him with the crop duster, but... I don't know. The machine gun kind of negates that. I regret that.
Sounds like a brilliant commentary, that one.
We'll talk about it more later. It's not as bad as I'm making it.
I'm pretty sure you also never see the machine gun.
No, you don't.
It's almost like...
You never see the pilot.
No. And if you get two people die, you see that in the paper, don't you?
Yeah.
So presumably,
and you don't see the thugs anymore in the rest of the film.
No, you see one of them. One of the guys at the start is never there for the rest of the film. Like he's just.
Oh, right, he just disappears.
But I think it was assumed that he was the pilot of the plane.
Yeah.
This is something that particularly bothered me watching the film this time, because it's established at the start he's a bit of a player. He's been married three times. He meets her on the train. She's clearly a bit of a player. They get it on. You think that's fine.
No, she's a player because she's working for the FBI.
Yeah, but hang on. Yeah.
It's not naturally. She's just working.
Exactly. Okay. But then when he discovers that she lied to him, he acts like he's suddenly got a broken heart. And yes. It just doesn't make any sense to me. I'm like, what's your problem? You're a player. She's a player. You got together.
You kind of got what you wanted, mate.
You got what you wanted. And then he turns around and she's kind of this fallen woman. And I can't get my head around it. It doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
At Hitchcock's insistence, the film was made in Paramount's VistaVision widescreen process, making it one of only two VistaVision films made at MGM. The other was apparently High Society.
I think it was a fashion thing as well. It was big at the time. That was a new technology, and these big, vibrant films are coming out. So I think that, you know, he was very much someone who wanted to be ahead of the game in fashion and film, and that's an example of that.
So let's talk a little bit about the iconic cast from North by Northwest. So we've spoken about him a little bit, but Cary Grant plays Roger Thornhill, looking as tanned as ever, I must say. The Blu-ray brings it out even more.
Oh, absolutely. He's golden brown. Yep.
So, I mean, what can we say that hasn't really been said?
I think... interesting thing for me about Cary Grant, and I've only seen a couple of Cary Grant films, and on the Blu-ray there's a quite a good documentary about Cary Grant, and just kind of a bio-doco, which was really handy to fill in some of the backstory. But I guess worth mentioning straight out of the bat is that George Clooney is compared to Cary Grant a lot. And after watching this film, you can see why George Clooney is compared to Cary Grant a lot. But the other thing worth noting is George Clooney is nowhere near Cary Grant in real terms. I get why. Like
is this the second time that you've dissed George Clooney on Real Chat?
Yep.
Why not, man? Why not?
Can we get a counter to go alongside the Back to the Future one?
What did I do last time? What did I say last time about George Clooney? I can't remember.
It was negative, though, and he was quite upset. You should have seen his Twitter feed afterwards.
Oh, really? He's been listening to Real Chat? I just think Cary Grant is unique. He's peerless, almost. He, if not peerless. But no, just bringing George Clooney up is just to give a comparison. For people that don't know who Cary Grant is at all, there's no question George Clooney is a fan of Cary Grant. There's no question that he's trying to create that suave, sophisticated kind of persona that Cary Grant has in all his films. But I think George Clooney has a sense of irony about his sophistication and suaveness, whereas Cary Grant just nails it that little bit more, and it just comes across. And it was a persona. The documentary I watched details how his real life, he was nothing like that. He was a working-class boy growing up. He was a hard-working actor. But he built this persona over a number of decades. And in North by Northwest, we are seeing the finished product, well and truly, of this very sophisticated, intelligent, suave character. And he owns it. Not once, even though there's a lot of winks and nods in this film, not once is he winking and nodding about the fact that he's a sophisticated, intelligent man. He just nails that persona, and he carries it throughout this film. Many of his films, he carries it. But, yeah, he does a great job.
Stu, are you a fan of his work in this film?
Yeah, it's fantastic. It's interesting you talked about his tan, because it gets a bit worse in To Catch a Thief.
Worse?
Oh, yeah.
It's really full on in that.
Jeez.
It's almost like he's doing blackface. It's very strange.
Oh,
no.
I heard that when he died he wasn't cremated, he was turned into wallets. So that is some good tanned leather. That's all I'm saying. Is that insulting after I just complimented him so much?
Apparently George Clooney's wallets aren't as good either.
I'll leave the man alone.
I think for the points we've said, I mean, he is the sole reason this film works, I think. And his knowing tongue-in-cheek performance makes everything work. The awkward kind of flirtations. I mean, Eva Marie Saint is probably one of the weakest links in the film in terms of acting. And I think I'm going to put it out there.
That's harsh.
And he makes it work. You know, he kind of she's a bit wooden, and it's a little bit kind of cheesy. And he makes it kind of work and
all
believable.
All of a sudden, I don't feel so bad for George Clooney.
Okay, if I could just point out, actually, the worst performer in it is the creepy maitre d' right at the start of the film. Who has one line, and before he says this really bizarre, creepy line, seems to look down to try to hit his mark. Go back and watch the first 10 minutes of the film. It took me out of the film momentarily. So just leave Eva alone, okay? At least
just see the young boy who's yelling at Kaplan at the start. You're talking about him?
No, or? No. The maitre d'. He goes into a restaurant just before he gets kidnapped. Yeah, the guy that shows him to his table. Yeah, it's very bizarre.
I don't know. I think the two thugs are kind of a bit light on too. You've got stuck into Eve Marie Saint straight off. That's just harsh.
I think the thugs have great faces though. They don't.
They do,
much.
But they're not doing anything.
Oh, they're
totally kind of bored. Broadcast. But I do love the thugs as they're escorting him out of the restaurant at the Plaza Hotel. It's great. It's a really nice little moment.
How good is that line?
It's like we've got concealed weapons, joke. And one of them's pointed at you. Yeah.
Cars waiting outside. You will walk between us, saying nothing.
What are you talking about?
Let's go.
Let's go where? Who are you?
Mere errand boys carrying concealed weapons. His is pointed at your heart. So please, no errors of judgment, I beg of you.
Oh, come on, fellas. What is this, a joke or something?
Yes, a joke. We were laughing in the car.
That's great. That's some great dialogue. But anyway, I thought Eve Marie Saint was really...
Well, I'll move on to her then. So Eve Marie Saint plays Eve Kendall.
Yeah.
Bruce, what are your impressions of her in this film?
I think she does a great job. I think it's hard to stand alongside Cary Grant and hold your own. And not only Cary Grant, but we'll get to him in a minute as well.
James Mason.
I think she does a great job. I think she's charming. I think she's charismatic. And I think obviously she looks gorgeous all the way through it. But I don't know. It's a tough role. I think she does really well.
Yeah, that opening scene with her is borderline absurd. Like, she's coming on so strong, and she does it quite well.
Yeah.
So. And you could see that this is the only woman that would make his character pause for thought, basically.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
The moment I meet an attractive woman, I have to start pretending I've no desire to make love to her.
What makes you think you have to conceal it?
She might find the idea objectionable.
Then again, she might not.
Think how lucky I am to have been seated here.
Well, luck had nothing to do with it.
Fate?
I tipped the steward $5 to seat you here if you should come in.
Is that a proposition?
I never discuss love on an empty stomach.
You've already eaten.
But you haven't.
James Mason, we just spoke about him. Philip Van Damme. Yeah, how do you guys think he does? Like I mentioned at the start, he's quite the charming villain. At least he literally came across like that to me.
This is nothing for Mason, this role. It's nothing for him. It's a walk in the park, and he nails it. He's great. He's got this silent, quiet, calm, sophisticated menace about him. And you just... Like, I just want to hear more from him. Like, he's barely in this film, really.
Yeah, you want more. He's just in it too little.
And there's nothing wrong with that. Like, it's nice to leave a film going, oh, I'd like to have seen more of James Mason. And he's brilliant. I think he absolutely nails it. One of the things he has to do earlier in the film is... You know, he basically convinces Thornhill that he is, speaking in front of the UN the next day or whatever. Like, he brings that kind of... Like, there's nothing cowardly, there's nothing... I don't know. Mason's brilliant. I love him. I think he's great in this.
Did you know that he suffered a severe heart attack shortly after the filming of this film?
It was too much stress for him, was it?
Possibly.
There was the auction.
Apparently, it was very
the auction
after.
Scene. That's the it was
interesting you bring up the auction scene because I was thinking that's the one scene that needs to be cut down to size in the film. It slows right down to the auction scene.
It's funny.
I think the timing's slightly out on it.
It outstays its welcome. It's,
does it?
It slows the film right down. I didn't.
Jeez, you're brutal in this film today, Stu.
I know. Well, it's interesting. It's interesting because.
No, Stu's right. This is a piece of crap. I don't know why we're looking at it. Let's look at the remake of Rear Window with Christopher Reeve.
The Death Wish.
No, that's Charles Bronson, not Van Damme. We're talking about Mason, though.
Yeah, that's fine.
He's great, isn't he?
Yeah, he's great. I stood up for Eva Marie Saint. That's fine.
Jesse Royce Landis plays Clara Thornhill. How do you think she does in the film as his mum, even though she's really only 7 years older than Cary Grant?
Eight. Thank you very much.
Seven, eight, yes.
She's great. I mean, she's only there for a short while. It's believable.
It's a nice moment because we hear about the mother beforehand, and then when she shows up, you're not disappointed. She kind of follows. You know what I mean? Like, we kind of know this character before we see her. And then when we see her, you're like, oh, yeah. And there's some nice interplay in that obviously there's the overbearing mother stuff. And then there's that nice scene where he calls up Kaplan's room and gets his mum to go and get the key for it. And that's kind of cute. It's kind of a nice little moment. And, I think she does a great job.
One of the best scenes in the film, I reckon, one of the funniest scenes is the scene in the lift.
You gentlemen aren't really trying to kill my son, are you?
Ha 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 Lobby, please. Watch your step.
It's almost like a surreal moment where everyone just starts laughing, and it's just... It's tense. It's still tense and suspenseful, but it's just this ludicrous moment, which is just brilliantly done.
I love that moment. That's great.
Great moment. Yeah.
And are there any members of the supporting cast, guys?
That Martin Landau. Martin Landau's worth mentioning. He owns this. he's just the tall, lanky, creepy guy, but he's really good. He's solid. So he's James Mason's right-hand man.
That's right. Yes.
But you also get a sense in the film that maybe Mason is the face of the operation and maybe Martin Landau's character has a little bit more control or a little bit more contact with whoever the bosses are anyway. So there's a really nice dynamic, and he's got this, for someone who's just this tall, lanky kind of guy, he's got this kind of scary kind of eeriness about him that I like.
His role in Entourage as well is really great.
Yeah, Martin Landau's brilliant. He's great. Yeah. Rhymes and Misdemeanors, he's great too.
If we're talking about supporting characters, can we talk about extras?
Yes.
Because, of course, this was the very first instance I can remember of seeing a blooper in a film. And it's quite a famous one, being at Mount Rushmore when they're in the cafe, just before the gun goes off, the kid sitting right behind them puts his fingers in his ears.
Ah, yes.
Oh,
to block his ears from the sound.
He didn't. Oh, it's, no. Once you know it's there, it's really, really obvious. So obviously it was take whatever, and he's a bit sick of the
one of the greatest bloopers ever, I think, that one. That is just so good.
So it's quite legendary.
Famous blooper.
Yeah, cool.
The very first time I can remember even knowing what a blooper was. It didn't occur to me that there were mistakes in movies before.
He's just like eyeing it off. He's just watching the action, just like waiting to know when he puts his...
So the question is, did Hitchcock leave that take in because he liked that idea? Is it an Easter egg?
Not.
Or is it just an accident?
It's probably just an accident.
It's probably too busy thinking about his next film.
It's probably
film.
The best take, yeah.
Yeah.
They probably debated over whether they'd use that or a slightly worse take, and then they went in.
There's a good cameo here as well, Brose, in the courtroom scene. Edward Platt.
Edward Platt! Yeah. It's great! And I love it because he delivers... You can hear him delivering the end of Thornhill's story about being kidnapped and not really believing it, but giving it a good hard go. Such a tough piece of dialogue to deliver, and he's great. Edward Platt is so good.
He's going to be known as the Chief.
The Chief, yeah. Would you believe Edward Platt? but yeah, he's great. I got excited when I saw his name in the opening credits. I was like, this is awesome.
Hold on.
There are two plats that I get excited about, credits. Oliver and Edward.
Opening credits, you mean the credits?
The credits.
Because there is
no credits at all.
If we can talk about the credits, it was interesting watching it this time, and a more recent film that references those credits would be Panic Room.
Of course.
The letters emblazoned across the buildings in a kind of three-dimensional space. It's almost... an updated version of that.
Yeah, nice. Lehman does talk about how he finds some of the names disappear in the tapering off, and he wasn't really happy with that. But
oh, really?
He was told to shut up a few times by the sound of it when he when he mentions it. It's like, oh, no one ever cared about this, but anyway. But yeah, they're great credits. And when it dissolves into the side of the building, I'd never seen this film before. I thought that was brilliant because I couldn't work out. I mean, the angles are there because Hitchcock likes to unnerve you anyway. So I assume that was, you know, that's part of his credit sequence. He likes to do something that's going to thematically set you up for the film. And then when it dissolves into the building, I thought that was brilliant. Something quite simple but very well done.
And they also changed the Leo the Lion MGM trademark.
Yeah, green. It's green. Yeah.
Yeah.
And on Blu-ray, that looks amazing. Those colours just pop out, don't they? Brilliant.
Hitchcock's cameo appearances are a signature occurrence in most of his films. In North by Northwest, he is seen getting a bus door slammed in his face literally just as his credit is appearing on the screen.
It was at this point that he was making sure he was in the films really early because everyone knew about it and people wouldn't pay attention to the film.
Exactly. So he's getting it out of the way.
Yeah, he gets it out of the way super early. Some of his old ones, he doesn't turn up for ages, but that was before people knew to look out for it.
Unlike the straight-ahead spy-fi that Hitchcock pioneered in films like The 39 Steps and The Man Who Knew Too Much, North by Northwest was the first espionage film that freaked the genre with outright comedy. While early examples of spy-fi deviated into horror and later ones mashed in sci-fi, Hitchcock's 1959 thriller was the first to splice it together with screwball laughs.
There is a real sense of screwball comedy in this film, definitely.
The result, a postmodern pleasure, I think. Laughs include the auction scene, the scenes of Thornhill drunk driving, which is hilarious, and the dialogue and the seduction scene, which we've spoken about before as well. What do you guys think of the comedy in this film? I personally was chuckling a lot throughout this movie.
Well, like I said earlier, it's a tricky balance to strike, and particularly the drunk driving scene. I mean, you're supposed to be worried for him.
Exactly,
but at the same time, it's hilarious, and it's just amazing that it works. In my head, I'm like, there's so many ways that could have gone wrong.
Even the nature of the effects, which are quite dated now, it's because you're focused on Cary Grant and his comedic performance, you kind of, everything else is, you forget about and you just enjoy the moment. And it is tough at times because you do get worried and you're waiting for something to go wrong, but at the same time, he's hilarious as a drunk driver. Yeah.
My favorite shot in this entire movie, the UN sky shot. You know the shot I'm talking about?
The matte painting.
Yeah. Shortly after Cary Grant's self-importance, Roger Thornhill is caught with a murder weapon in his hand at the United Nations. He races out of the building and into Hitchcock's stunning shot. Filmed from atop the United Nations, the effect is a moving painting, partially frozen in a brilliant frame that resembles the Metropolitan Circuit Board. I reckon it's absolutely unreal. I love the shot.
Oh, I know the shot you mean. Because I was watching that shot thinking, surely part of that's painted, but there's movement and there's... blown away. There's a lot of matte paintings in this film.
Yep.
I love matte paintings and I love when they're used well and I think they look gorgeous. And there are recent films where they've discussed using matte paintings and then changed their mind and used CGI at last minute. And it's a real lost art in Hollywood. The sequence when he gets into the convertible when he's drunk, there's a matte painting that's all shot on a backlot with, I think, film of the ocean in the background. And then there's the matte painting when he walks into the UN. The lobby of the UN is a matte painting as well. They couldn't get permission to shoot inside the UN.
The hotel early on, actually, there's a nice forced perspective shot with a mirror clearly halfway down the hallway. I'm not sure if anyone noticed, but it was a fake hallway.
Yeah, nice. Oh, yeah.
Also, walking into the UN, presumably you all know they couldn't get the legal okay to film.
Yeah,
Cary Grant walking into the UN. So yeah, they sneakily did it.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah. They just got Cary Grant to walk up the steps and, you know, sneakily did the shot themselves.
Yeah, get out of a cab and they just shot it from the other side of the road. It looks great too.
That was the highlight of the film visually for me. But there is a part that really bugs me in this movie. I don't know if it's a dated thing. I don't know if it's something that wasn't as important back then. Towards the end of the movie when you've got Van Damme and Eva walking towards the plane.
Yes.
It goes from one shot to the other.
The same plate.
And the background is very, very jarring.
Yeah, it's the same plate. So it's just like they cut from one actor to another on the same plate.
Exactly.
I noticed that for the first time watching it just the other night. It just jumps and it just kind of takes you out.
It's almost like the background plate is actually in a slightly different position.
Yeah.
Because it moves and it's very,
which is weird. Like, they could have just shot it in a two shot and it would have been fine. But
do you know the shot I'm talking about?
I didn't notice it this time, so I don't.
I've not noticed it either. But I've only seen this film twice now, so.
Yeah, it was really distracting for me visually. Yeah, okay. Like, it was like, oh, is this something that they see nothing like?
Look, it sounds most likely that... they had no choice, and that's the only version of the shot they had.
I mean, there's a lot of back projection in a lot of Hitchcock's films, and some of it works well, some of it doesn't.
Well, there was a lot of back projection because so much was shot in the studio.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not on location as much.
That's right. But, you know, like when they're exiting the train and he's dressed as the luggage handler guy.
Oh, yeah.
That's back. And I think that works really well. Like, you don't really notice that.
It looks like they're on a treadmill, though. It does a bit.
Once you realise, yes.
Yeah.
That didn't pop out for me at all. That didn't unnerve me. That was fine.
I think this is the point after which it started to get a bit dodgier.
Yeah.
Because, I watched Torn Curtain on Blu-ray recently, and it really stands out there. And on Frenzy, there's some shots as well that just don't work.
Just a quick frequently asked question about the actual film itself. Why do Valerian and Licht think that Thornhill is Kaplan?
I only realised this on the second time I watched it. The page is walking around the restaurant paging Kaplan, and he puts his hand up, calls him over to call his mother. They watch that.
I told my secretary to call mother, and I realised she won't be able to reach her where she is. Well,
why not?
Well, she's playing bridge at the apartment of one of her cronies.
Your secretary?
No, my mother. George Kaplan. Well, it's brand new apartments, all wet paint and no telephone yet.
Perhaps if I sent her a telegram.
Mr.
George Kaplan.
The first time I saw it, I didn't notice the subtlety of that, but they watch him call the busboy over or whatever, thinking he's Kaplan.
That's it.
Yeah.
It's just that one moment.
Yep. They haven't been watching him for weeks, watching his behaviour and noting it.
That bloody kid. He doesn't realise what he just put
what him
through.
What he just did, yeah, exactly.
That's terrible.
Yep.
He should have gone, Kaplan. Over here, son. Oh, Kaplan doesn't exist and he's not here. What do you want, sir?
Yeah.
The whole film would have been ended right there. That's it. All over.
Now that you think about it, it is very subtle. Like,
very.
It is, yeah. I watched it twice within a couple of days and it was on the second viewing.
Yeah.
It
just, and because it's in the first 5 minutes, you're not picking up.
Because you don't even know that it's important.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As the screenwriter here, Stu, what can you tell us about a MacGuffin?
The MacGuffin isn't in the film that much, is it? We're talking about it's a microfilm, isn't it, inside the statue?
Yes.
The microfilm.
Nice Loaded Weapon touch this.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to the day we get to do Loaded Weapon 1.
I can't wait till we do 2.
I'm still waiting for that one.
Yeah, we all are.
I'm waiting over 20 years.
Yeah. What can you say about the MacGuffin? The whole point is it doesn't really matter what it is. It's just there to drive the plot forward. But as I say, it doesn't have quite as big a role in this film as some of the other Hitchcock films. Yeah. It doesn't appear until quite late.
Lehman in the commentary also mentions that obviously the statuette with the microfilm is the MacGuffin. He also refers to George Kaplan as being a MacGuffin.
Yeah, that's true.
For him as well.
It's dumb.
In that it's not that important to the plot, especially once we get to the Eve Marie Saint, Cary Grant plot in the second half of the film. So yeah, he kind of says there's kind of two MacGuffins
and
in this one.
Like, it doesn't matter who George Kaplan is because he doesn't exist.
Yeah.
So yeah. Yeah.
So a physical object that everyone in the film is chasing, but which has no deep relationship whatsoever to the plot of the film.
Is a MacGuffin. Yes.
Just before people turn off the podcast. Yeah. What the hell are they talking about?
A recent example of MacGuffin is the Clint Eastwood film. Gran Torino is a perfect example of a modern MacGuffin. That Gran Torino is the name of the film. Gran Torino is featured throughout the film, but it's not that important to the plot. And it is something that characters are kind of striving for. You know, it's something that is coveted. But it's kind of irrelevant.
Yeah, the Mission Impossible films do it as well.
Yeah, throwing a MacGuffin.
They're after the rabbit's foot in one of those. Is that
what about the exposition scene with the agents in the office?
Yeah, I
always laugh when that scene comes up.
I don't know whether... What was it?
Here's for all you folks who are a bit confused.
Yeah. And there's that line in there about, I don't know if I should... It was all very sad, but why do I feel like laughing?
I love that.
Oh, some guy's about to die. We just found out he's the third guy that's going to die because of this George Kaplan.
Those shadowy government agencies,
oh,
man.
Love laughing at a bit of death, don't they?
Just a couple of little bits of trivia here, guys. Hitchcock said that MGM wanted North by Northwest cut by 15 minutes so the film's length would run under 2 hours. Hitchcock had his agent check his contract, learned that he had absolute control over the final cut, and refused. I actually think that this movie actually runs a little bit too long.
It does.
I would actually say that MGM probably got that right.
I've actually say a couple of the Hitchcock films that are the most highly praised are the ones that are actually a tad too long. Because, I always find Vertigo
Vertigo
that bit
feels
too
a bit long.
And Rear Window would have to be one of my favourite Hitchcocks, but it takes a long time before it starts. That first 20 minutes
it's
is very slow.
Film. So yeah. Slow starting. Even Psycho, which is a much tighter film, it's under 2 hours, isn't it?
I thought that was quite a short film, but I can't remember. I haven't
seen
it for a
while.
Yeah,
from memory it seems like a short film. But, again, the start of that film, it takes a long time to get to the film, really, to Bates Motel. And it's a nice setup, and obviously that setup's been praised a million times, but after watching it, I wouldn't mind if
they have an excuse there because they shocked everyone
by
resetting almost and starting again after that half hour. So
it still feels a bit longish these days.
One of Eva Marie Saint's lines in the dining car seduction scene was redubbed. She originally said, "I never make love on an empty stomach," but it was changed in post-production to, "I never discuss love on an empty stomach."
Oh, naughty.
Of course, the censors considered the original version too risky.
That's right. And, in the 50s, women just sat around on train cars talking about love and making love. They just talk about making love. That's what they would do because it's so much nicer. Full stomachs.
It's one of those moments in films where I'm a bit distracted by the fact that they order food and never eat.
But then his food is taken away.
Yeah.
There's a plate there with consumed food, like the remains of the fish or whatever, and you're like, hey, when did that...
Yeah, the only time, even probably the time it's bothered me the most is my dinner with Andre, where the entire film is them eating dinner, but they're talking the entire time,
and
they can't
eat anything.
Their dinner. So they take have like 5 courses.
You've just got to assume that when they're doing the reverse shot, the guy's just shoveling food in his mouth while he's listening. I want to see those outtakes.
Cuts back to Wallace Shawn, he's got food sticking out of his mouth. Cheeks bulging.
Like a squirrel. I love it.
While filming Vertigo, Alfred Hitchcock described some of the plot of this project to frequent Hitchcock leading man and Vertigo star James Stewart, who naturally assumed that Hitchcock meant to cast him in the Roger Thornhill role and was very eager to play it as well, apparently. Hitchcock wanted Cary Grant to play the role, so by the time Hitchcock realised the misunderstanding, Stewart was so anxious to play Thornhill that rejecting him would have caused a great deal of disappointment. So Hitchcock delayed production on this film until Stewart was already safely committed to filming Anatomy of a Murder before officially offering him the North by Northwest role. So Stewart had no choice. He had to turn down the offer, allowing Hitchcock to cast Grant.
Apparently his quote is going, "Oh, wow, Alfred, what's..."
Is that your Jimmy Stewart impersonator? role of Jimmy Stewart will be played by a cockatoo.
Yeah, that music compilation I'm going to put together of Andy. Does that go in there? Yeah.
What a great remix that's going to be.
Did you guys know that Thornhill appears on the left side of the screen for almost the entire movie?
Oh, there you go. Yeah.
There's a really weird moment when they're getting into the cab at the start of the film as well. Like, Cary Grant actually puts his secretary in first.
Yeah.
And then when they cut to, like, the set inside
they swap sides.
He steps over her.
It doesn't make any sense. Yeah, he steps past her.
It doesn't make any sense. No. It's like he's on the wrong side of the cab, like, you know, when you go inside. So that was a sort of a weird sort of oversight there. So let's talk a little bit about the good old DVD and Blu-ray releases of North by Northwest, guys. So there was originally the 2001 DVD. I assume that most of you guys picked this up.
Yeah, I might actually mention I was really excited that we were doing this podcast and I have an excuse to watch my North by Northwest Blu-ray, which I haven't watched yet. Sat down, knew I had a certain amount of time to watch it, and realized that that was one of the few Hitchcock films I hadn't upgraded to Blu-ray. So I had to watch the DVD.
Was it this 2001 DVD?
Presumably, yeah. Yeah, that's the one. Which... you'll be delighted to know it looks quite good on an HD TV still. Some DVDs do, some DVDs don't. This one still looks good, so...
Yeah, but Blu-ray's better.
I was actually going to ask, what do people think about the Blu-ray?
Because
I was thinking the visual effects on the DVD were starting to look a bit dodgy, and I'm wondering, did they look even worse on DVD on Blu-ray?
Yes.
Okay.
But the film looks amazing.
Give me an example of what looks bad to you.
Oh, it's just the old school effects, Andrew. Like, you know, like the Blu-ray the clarity of Blu-ray just brings out.
I still reckon the matte paintings look fantastic.
They do.
Yeah, the matte paintings don't age. I'm not talking about the matte paintings. But
I'm talking about a lot of the rear projection stuff.
Rear projection stuff doesn't look great. But to me, it doesn't look as bad.
It looks cleaner.
Yeah. I mean, I've got The Birds on DVD, and I think some of the rear projection on that looks worse than North by Northwest on Blu-ray. Well, so
The Birds is one you have to get in Blu-ray because it's actually in widescreen.
Oh, there you go. I'll have to dig that up. But I've seen Hitchcock films where the rear projection has aged not as well as I thought North by Northwest did.
Okay, because apparently one of the best instances of not wanting high def is The Exorcist, because apparently once the Blu-ray version came out, all the makeup suddenly looked really fake and plasticky, which it never had. And I've seen a good argument that says the best way to see The Exorcist is on scratchy old videotape.
I can see how that works in its favour.
Sure, the makeup artist really appreciates that review.
I saw the anniversary edition of Exorcist on DVD and thought it was solid, but I've not seen the Blu-ray.
But this 2009 Blu-ray, or the 50th anniversary edition, is sensational. Yeah, it looks incredible.
So I have to buy it, is that what you're saying?
It's like Tim.
How much do you like this film?
I've worked so hard to not simply upgrade all my DVDs to Blu-ray, you know?
Didn't you mention as well, Stu, that this is something that Real Chat is actually working against your budget here or something?
I've actually saved all my receipts and I've brought them in for you to reimburse me. Because after Real Chat, I'm like, I need to get the latest Ghostbusters Blu-ray, I need to get this, that,
so is this a combination of the Real Chat podcast and also my written
The companion blog. You should go to the website and check it out.
Self-promoting here, aren't we, Adam Stolfo, right?
It's also, in case you two haven't read it, Adam gets to have the last word, because he reviews the film on the companion blog as well.
That's true. That is true. But you can check out my fine work in the Matador barbecue ads appearing throughout the Cricket World Cup. I'll be on TV. You can see me there.
Andrew, do you want to plug something?
I made a nice dinner last night.
Oh, what was it?
It was a stir fry.
I hope you took some pictures to put up on Instagram, all right?
I'll get busy in the... I'll pull out of the bin.
I do think the Real Chat Instagram account has been a bit too filmically biased. We need some food photos in there.
That's true. Has there been any film photos yet? This is ridiculous. We'll get to the bottom of this. We'll sort it out. What did I say? Film. I think we could get a few more pictures up from Ghostbusters too. I don't know.
Hey.
Not Ghostbusters 2, but Ghostbusters as well.
Let's talk about North by Northwest. I find, it looks... Well, obviously the best it's ever looked, and it just the scale of it really comes out on the Blu-ray. It's just big bold images, and the VistaVision colours are just
it looks fantastic. Yeah. It looks amazing.
That opening sequence in the city with the hustle and bustle of the people leaving work, it just pops at you.
I hate you guys.
You do get the feel. Those instances where you get to, like, if you go to somewhere like the Astor or any of those. Cinemas that show older films, when you actually get to sit down and watch a full 70mm print or a VistaVision print or any of those big, you get that sense from this DVD. You really get that instant kind of shot in the head, like, wow, this is big, and it was a big scale film. And like, if I'd watched this at midnight on TV as a kid, I guess other things would be in the focus. But you do get a great sense of the visual mastery of Hitchcock's direction, and it just is, it's spectacular. It's really, it's a great DVD, great Blu-ray.
It's great.
It's off a 4K master, I think. Yeah, so it's just, it's got every detail.
It's a 50 gig file.
Yeah.
The film on Blu-ray is a 50 gig file, yeah.
There's a commentary on this Blu-ray as well, Brose.
There is a commentary which was recorded for the original DVD release, and it's included on the Blu-ray release. It is Ernest Lehman, who is the script writer of this film. He is well into his 80s by the time he does this commentary. Listening closely, you can tell that elements of it are interviewed, and they've cut the questions out, and then they've just edited them over to the appropriate moments, which is great. And that's the way more commentaries should be, a little bit more structured, a little bit more produced, and especially an 85, 86-year-old man who doesn't necessarily know what the commentary is or how it works is explained to him, and then he's done it. So if he'd been left to his own devices, it would have been a very interesting meandering exercise, I'm sure.
So it's almost like you need more directors in audio commentaries to just poke and prod people in a certain direction. Is that what you're saying?
Well, just have a plan. Don't go in and just, expect to be able to talk about it. The first 20 minutes of the commentary are a bit weird in that he's literally commentating the film, but then he starts getting onto the anecdotes and the stories and the creation of the script, and he was there for some of the filming, so he talks about anecdotes on about being on set. One of the things Lehman did, and he talks about it in the commentary, and it's kind of cute, but he did a lot of research for this film, which he then calls procrastinating. Every location in this film he visited, every location when he wrote the scene based on that location, he'd been there and he knew exactly what he was talking about. So something like in Chicago, when there's that great tracking shot of the phone booths and we see Eve Marie Saint in one end and then we see Marty Landau in the other end, he knew exactly which phone booths Hitchcock should use and how he should shoot it because he'd been there. He makes a reference to Hitchcock telling him, telling Lehman, why do you keep telling me how to direct a film? And then Lehman apparently turns around and says, well, why do you keep telling me how to write one? and the other great thing about this commentary is you get a sense that Lehman and Hitchcock were actually friends. He's not a screenwriter that, had three meetings with him and now he's doing a commentary pretending they were best mates. These guys spent a month, month and a half trying to come up with the idea for North by Northwest when they were supposed to be writing The Wreck of the Duva. So it's not a forced or faked friendship. You can tell these guys were genuine mates and that they got along really well. It's slow. It is slightly slow. It's not a high energy commentary, obviously.
Is it true that you can hear his pacemaker during the recordings?
Not that I could hear. Maybe they've taken that out in the Blu-ray. Is that a real rumor?
That's a joke.
Or is that a joke? You were so serious that I couldn't tell. You couldn't tell.
You had an issue with that in previous episodes.
I don't always get jokes. you can't hear his pacemaker. Look, it's not a five-star commentary by any means. If you're a Hitchcock fan, you've probably already watched it, if not recently when you first picked this up on DVD. And it's worth another look because there are some really nice stories. A lot of the trivia and facts about this film, at least anything from the last 10 years, come directly from this commentary.
Yeah, cool.
So he added something to this film that previously hadn't been talked about, and there are two or three comments he makes, and he says, I've never mentioned that out loud before. For example, the crop dusting scene, the machine gun that I mentioned earlier, he says, I've never said that out loud to anyone before, but it's something that's always bugged me. So it's really nice. He's giving some really nice insights, and he's a genuine, warm man. It's a great commentary.
Yeah, cool. And there's a couple of other things on here. I think some of this stuff's come across from the DVD, but I know that they added some new stuff to the Blu-ray as well. There's the Master's Touch, Hitchcock's Signature Style, which is an hour-long documentary. It's like an introductory course on Hitchcock's directorial trademarks. There's something called Destination Hitchcock, The Making of North by Northwest, about 40 minutes long, hosted by Eva Marie Saint, apparently. Yep. North by Northwest, One for the Ages. A-grade directors give their expert analysis on the film. And then, I think you just mentioned this before, Brose, this really long feature-length documentary called Cary Grant, A Class Apart.
It's 90 minutes. It's a PBS documentary, and they do a great series of kind of celebrity documentaries that they've done for a long time now. And it's nice. It's really tight. They talk to Eva Marie Saint. They talk to a couple of his ex-wives. They talk to, I know, he had four or five wives. I don't know. He clocked them up, that's for sure. And it's nice. If you don't know who Cary Grant is, it tells you exactly who Cary Grant is, and you have a whole new appreciation for him as an actor. And you get a sense of who the hell this guy is. You know, people refer to him as being, one of the greatest actors of all time and blah, blah, blah. It's worth differentiating, and they differentiated in the documentary. Cary Grant was not a Marlon Brando or a Jimmy Dean. He was a star. He was a movie star of the classic cinema period, and he was great at it. And it's a great documentary. It's worth watching. It is it doesn't seem like 90 minutes. It travels cool. quite well, yeah, and it covers it his whole life, and it's really tasty. Some of the other content on this Blu-ray, you've watched anything else on this Blu-ray at this point, or you've had a look over it?
I've had a bit of a scan. I haven't looked at it in detail yet.
There's a little bit of a sense with some of the other stuff, including that Cary Grant documentary, arguably, where they've just kind of, what have we got the rights for? What can we dump on this Blu-ray? Some of the other stuff I'm not sure, but definitely the stuff I looked at, it's not necessarily created for this Blu-ray. It's just stuff that complements the movie. Hitchcock and Cary Grant aren't from anywhere. They're not specific to this movie.
But there's something on the North by Northwest film directly with the interviews with directors, like
Their reactions to this film or their
Curtis Hanson and Guillermo del Toro.
That was the one,
what's his name?
Guillermo.
Yeah.
That was the one for the Ages documentary.
Mr. Del Toro.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All those A-grade directors, yeah.
Yeah, that's quite interesting.
Yeah, whereas I know on the Psycho, I've got the DVD, but the Psycho DVD, there's a lot of information about the making of that film and the marketing of that film, and it's incredibly fascinating to me, whereas this is a little bit slightly more removed, but it's great. It's a great package.
And there's a great feature on this, on both the DVD and the Blu-ray, which is really rare. It's not on many at all, right? And we'll lead this into the music very shortly as well, Andrew.
Oh, yeah.
There's a music-only track, or an isolated score, I think they refer to them as. So you can isolate Bernard Herrmann's, quite classy score. But it's a rare feature. I think one of the main reasons it's so rare is because of the fact that, people don't need the soundtrack release. But what I really like about it is the fact that it times it up with the movie itself. So rather than just listening to the score, you hear how the music sounds isolated alongside the visuals and the scene it's specifically composed for. There's a very small selection that have it. Not enough, though, because sometimes it's done really, really well. Does the 7-1 do it to an extent? Like, a little bit? Does it have isolated tracks?
Yeah, it does. It does. There's no commentary over the score moments.
Yeah.
I haven't been this excited about a special feature on a Blu-ray since Beauty and the Beast sing-along. So, you know, it's pretty tasty.
Isolated audio tracks, you could, what, a dozen DVDs have done this?
Not many.
Is it the Beetlejuice that has one?
I think so.
Yeah.
And then some films that really don't deserve it, like Bad Boys.
Really?
Does that really have isolated score?
Mark Mancina's amazing score, isolated. Bad Boys. Deadly serious.
Are the songs in there as well, or just the score? Like the
isolated?
Yeah.
Well, I haven't really looked at it in depth.
When we get to Bad Boys.
Yeah, well, when we get there, 2020. So for Bad Boys, let's not skip over this. Is the isolated score then played over the sequences it's from in the movie, or just slow-mo shots of Will Smith's muscles rippling in the sunlight covered in oil?
Let's talk back to North by Northwest. Let's talk a little bit about the score.
The score, yes.
From North by Northwest.
Yes. The fact that there is an isolated score, it just lends itself to how iconic this score is. It's an absolute classic, and even non-real movie fans kind of get into this film and appreciate the score for what it is. For me, it's like one of the first film scores that I listened to as a kid. It was just, that's how I discovered film scores, is through this very score, so it's got a lot of meaning to me. But yeah, I think that for a lot of the reason the film works is because of the score. Like, it's just an exceptional piece of work. It's humorous, it's exciting. There's a constant kind of rhythm to the music, which just propels the story forward. And even in those kind of scenes like the car ride where he's drunk, shouldn't work, but I think the music really adds to it and gives it this comic yet dramatic tone, which really works.
Has a great main theme as well.
Well, that's it. The main theme is, they call it a fandango, Adam. And that's apparently a Spanish folk piece of music. And the reason he chose that was because he thought that that would match the kind of dancer-like movements of Cary Grant. So that was the choice. But it's such an unusual choice of music for an American film. It's very exotic. And yeah, like it pops up throughout the whole film and just keeps the film moving along, which is what a good score should do.
And there's an official release of it as well?
There's been a few releases over the years, but there's the Rhino Records one is the one to get, because that just has every discernible cue in the film, like down from like a 30-second cue to a, really long one of 2 minutes and 30 seconds.
Whoa, that's a big cue.
It's even got the source tracks, which are these kind of quaint little kind of string quartet-y kind of background tracks from the bars that he goes to.
It's the complete score.
It's got everything.
Yeah.
Or you could just get the Blu-ray and have it on that.
True.
Do you think that a special feature on the Blu-ray, like the isolated score, would affect like CD or download sales of the score?
I don't think so. No,
it's pretty niche anyway, isn't it?
Yeah, it's pretty niche. And if I think people that want the CD want it for different reasons than they'd want the Blu-ray. Plus, you know, if you're a completist, you just want everything anyway. Give it to me now. Bring it to me. Give it to me. I want it now.
Exactly right. Spot on. Just in regards to deleted scenes or alternate versions of North by Northwest, I couldn't dig up that much on this movie, but... Well, I guess the reason for that is less than 8 feet of film was cut from the final release. For those of you that you don't know, 8 feet is about 5 seconds. So literally everything is pretty much in there.
Wow.
Which is interesting.
Was that Cary Grant picking his nose? Was it that thing?
Was a little scratch.
Take like
I
that.
Wanted to see that.
No, it was the shot of Cary Grant actually eating the fish on the train. He's very quick. I thought, well, it's so quick, we can just cut it out. Okay.
And the only other thing I could find is the print originally had an acknowledgement for the cooperation of the Department of the Interior and the National Park Service, but they requested to be removed after MGM violated the agreement that no violence would take place near the Mount Rushmore Monument.
Wow. Oops. Yeah. There's just a bit of that.
Lehman kind of contradicts himself in the commentary here when he talks about Mount Rushmore, but both are worth mentioning just quickly. First of all, he went to Mount Rushmore and attempted to climb it. And couldn't. And then
good to know.
And he talks about buying a Polaroid camera and sending someone else up Mount Rushmore to get the photos. And then that kind of sounds like a reason why they didn't shoot it there. And then they went and built it on a soundstage. But then he also mentions later on that they approached the Parks Department or whatever to shoot there, and they refused because of the violence. And then they reconstructed it. So yeah,
I love the fact that he actually, as a writer, went to all these locations. Like, he did full-on research and actually attempted to climb Mount Rushmore.
Well, the moment in the commentary...
The script, God damn it.
The moment in the commentary where he's already mentioned 3 or 4 times of his research and his extensive research, but that moment after he'd mentioned it 4 or 5 times and goes, well, you know, procrastinating, it's just a really cute, funny moment from...
Yeah.
If you've ever written... I don't know how many people have tried to sit down and write something. Yeah, I mean, we all have. And the procrastination is pretty good. And the fact that you've got a budget to travel all around America to procrastinate...
I know. Tell me about it.
...is great. But yeah, it's really cute. But yeah, Mount Rushmore this particular sequence in North by Northwest has inspired some great cinematic moments. The finale of the film version of Richie Rich shouldn't go unmentioned, I think. That's where Richie Rich is chased by John Larroquette out onto Mount Rushmore.
That was a Culkin classic,
and,
that one.
Wasn't it? Yeah. So, you know, it's not just Hitchcock. It's fairly influential, that sequence. Yeah.
Bruce, collectibles.
Oh, look. No.
I want a scale diorama of Mount Rushmore with the characters clinging off the faces.
I got Eva Marie Saint's dress ordered in online.
No, that's good. That's a replica. Collectibles for this film, from a lot of films in this era, we're talking about things like magazine covers and posters, and there'd be variant posters around the place. Obviously, different score releases and DVDs would fit into that category. But there are some really nice books that were produced about North by Northwest with some stunning photos and things in there, and a lot of detail about the history of the film and discussion about the film. So if you are a fan, it's worth tracking down at least that kind of thing, but there's nothing in terms of toys or bits and pieces, obviously.
In regards to the awards for this film, 3 Academy Award nominations, which are all of note, obviously. So Best Writing, Story and Screenplay, written directly for the screen to Ernest Lehman, got nominated. Best Art Direction and Set Decoration for the art department. And Best Film Editing as well to George Tomasini, apparently. So 3 significant nominations there.
No wins.
Can I just throw in a question to the table here? The crop dusting scene, just a quick throwback to that. Is it the first film to have the walking away from an explosion shot?
The cool guys walking
ever
away?
Ever in cinema history. Could it be?
It could
be. He doesn't look back at it?
He does. He kind of does.
It's it all promotion. Comes back to Bad Boys, doesn't it, fellas? Every time.
I want to try and link it back to that film.
Yeah, the only problem is he's not trying to look cool, but
that's
he's
true.
Cary Grant, so he's automatically cool.
True.
So it probably does count.
Yeah.
Definitely up there.
Could be.
It'll
could
be an instance at least.
One. Look into it.
The Rotten Tomatoes website certifies North by Northwest fresh 100%.
Yeah, fair
wow.
Enough.
That is fair enough.
62 positive reviews, not 1 negative.
Wow.
This is the first film we've done on Real Chat that's got
the
100%.
Only negative review is from Stu.
It's not a negative review.
And they deleted it. So
so that's the first on Real Chat, the first film we've looked at to get the perfect score, according to Rotten Tomatoes.
I thought it would have been Commando. But
yeah, apparently that's what I was backing.
And the very high IMDb score of 8.4 out of 10, which is exceptionally high, that's for sure. Time magazine called the film thoroughly entertaining. The New York Times made it a critic's pick. Author and journalist Nick Clooney praised Lehman's original story and sophisticated dialogue, calling the film certainly Alfred Hitchcock's most stylish thriller, if not his best. The film ranks at number 98 in Empire magazine's list of the 500 greatest films of all time.
We're 98?
Yep. The 500 greatest films of all time.
Oh, okay, that's not so bad. I'm sorry. Yep. No, I thought you said top in the 100.
Okay.
I thought you said top 100. Okay, carry on.
The Writers Guild of America ranked the screenplay number 21 on its list of 101 greatest screenplays ever written. And it's also ranked the 40th greatest American film by the American Film Institute. In 1995, North by Northwest was selected for preservation in the National Film Registry by the United States Library of Congress as being culturally, historically, and aesthetically significant. So that pretty much wraps this up, guys. So we're just going to finish this off with our traditional five-star review system. So I'm going to start with you over here, Andrew. What do you give North by Northwest, and would you recommend it?
It's one of those films that I think has had a huge influence on a lot of cinema since. Could almost say it's like a template for the James Bond film in a way.
Definitely.
I mean, it really did pave the way for that kind of film and the tone of that film. So got a lot to thank it for. And, every time I watch it, it's just it makes you laugh. It's exciting. Cary Grant is just such a watchable leading man. And the music, the photography, I mean, all elements come together. I mean, the A-team of Hitchcock's collaborators are at their best in this film. It's one I return to at least once a year. So I'd have to give it 5 stars.
Fantastic.
And I'd have to strongly come with a recommendation.
Awesome. Bruce?
5 stars, no question. Yeah, I mean, Hitchcock's a complicated director, and for that reason he's eminently enjoyable as well. There are a few films from Hitchcock that are probably good jumping offs. This is a good jumping off. Probably recommend a couple other films before you saw North by Northwest, but if you saw this first, you'd be fine and you'd want to revisit it anyway. So it's definitely a film now that I obviously own it now, and it'll be on high rotation in my house. It's a film I'll have to watch every year, I think.
So highly recommended.
Highly recommended.
Stu?
I'm going to say it's highly recommended, and then I'm going to give it 3.5 stars. Just to be different, why not?
Why not?
My complaints are only really in comparison to his other work. So, I mean, it's a high standard to begin with. And just like I said, it feels like I can see the seams a bit in the writing, how we're getting from one scene to another. I mean, the fact that the villain's house is apparently on top of Mount Rushmore is a little bit strange, because they actually seem to walk down a hill to then fall down onto the heads, which didn't make any sense to me at all. But, I mean, all those things, that's the best Hitchcock films are totally absurd, but he's such a good filmmaker, you don't think about that until you're watching it the 15th time. It's a great Hitchcock film. It's just not in my top 10 Hitchcock films.
Recommended, though?
Of course.
Yeah, good stuff.
Cool. Just quickly, because we are going to look at Hitchcock ongoing, Stu, jumping off films for Hitchcock if you're uninitiated.
Gosh, that's a big question.
Would you start with Psycho? Probably was the first film I saw from Hitchcock, but
you could show someone Psycho, but then there's not much else to compare it to.
Yeah. Or Rear Window is one I saw early as well. So
I'd have to do it. Rear Window.
Rear Window
is a jumping Hitchcock off film in my eyes.
Yeah, probably. Yeah.
Yeah. So if you are listening and you've not watched Hitchcock before, just before Adam gives us his review, Rear Window, and then jump off from there.
Well, Rear Window will be done in 2015.
Very soon.
Yes,
very soon.
Yes, it will be. So I'm giving the... which Stu's very excited about.
Yeah.
I'm giving the film 4 stars. I only have a couple little complaints with the film overall. Overall, I find it, like, you know, it's gripping, it's suspenseful, it's visually iconic, and it definitely set the groundwork for Bond. There's no doubt about that this time that I watched it through. I think it's a little bit long, but otherwise, like, you know, with the exception of a couple of things that you mentioned, Stu, about the sort of the formula of the script and the like, they're the only little things that I can pick at it. So I'm going to give it 4 stars and definitely recommend it from me. And now something new on Real Chat, The Assignment. Bruce, what can you tell us about this?
The assignment is simple, really. One of us is going to be challenged to watch a film that we would normally not watch, or a film we've always refused to watch. And then we need to come back to the group and have something positive to say about it. I'm hoping that some people will be surprised by the film, so they go and watch we're taking them out of their comfort zone and they might actually enjoy something. For example, Adam revealed earlier he hates musicals, so he'll be definitely watching a musical at some point in the short term. And there are a few films that we all have on our list that we don't want to watch or we never want to see for various reasons. And it's about just, you know, breaking down those prejudices a little bit and finding some enjoyment in somewhere we wouldn't normally. So we're challenging our real chat.
Do we get to be a little bit negative about it?
You've got to come back and be positive. If you've got nothing 60, nice to 40? Say, don't say anything at all.
Is that the rules?
No, it's not. But yeah, we're challenging you to go away, watch a film you wouldn't normally watch or a film you've refused to watch in the past and come back and say something positive about it. Give us a reason why you might, or at least try and understand why other people enjoy that film.
So are we staying this next couple of weeks or does someone want to give it a crack?
Wow, Stu's put his hand up already.
You did suggest it earlier.
We did, and I've completely forgotten what the fuck we talked about.
Psycho remake, wasn't it?
Ah, yes. Okay. So
what was tied into Hitchcock then?
Well, let's tie it back to Hitchcock. It was mentioned earlier that Stu has never seen the remake of the Gus Van Sant remake of Psycho.
Yes,
and why I believe have you not seen it?
The subtitle of that film is Pointless.
This is going to be a tough assignment because I've seen the remake a couple of times and can think of no positive elements of that film whatsoever. There is one, actually, but...
don't spoil it.
That is your assignment. You are challenged now to go away. Watch. Oh. Yeah, oh, this is going to be tough.
God.
Watch as much, if not all, of the remake of Psycho as you can and then come back and say something positive.
All right, there we go.
All right.
The assignment.
There you go. It's underway.
I'll do my best.
It's underway. Real Chat 2015. The assignment makes its debut. Okay. So that's it, guys. Thanks for coming and discussing North by Northwest with me today. It's been a lot of
fun. Not a problem. As I said at the top of the show, it's great to get to watch films that I haven't seen yet or films that I've always intended to see. So let's keep them coming. This is great.
Absolutely. So the next episode that we're going to look at is The Shawshank Redemption. So we're going to get Michael Hadjian in for that one and we're going to have a lot to talk about with that one, that's for sure. So thanks for coming along, guys.
Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
Pleasure.
Bye-bye. Stay in touch with us by visiting realchat.com.au. Check us out on Facebook. You can follow us on Twitter at realchatpodcast. Instagram, real_chat_podcast. And if you haven't already, catch up with past episodes and subscribe to new episodes on iTunes.